there's a bunch of mentions of boobs, tits, bappies, pappers, hanging sloppers, swinging punches. How you doing? It's Sunday 19th of July, Pretendship episode 41, and lockdown's over-ish, I don't know, we'll talk about that, tell some stories, got some shit going on with the podcast coming up, if you give a fuck, but yeah, just come inside and we'll have a chat. Welcome, 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 and well done, congratulations, we survived lockdown, didn't we? Well, I don't know if lockdown's over, but it effectively was ended when the pubs opened, I felt. People sort of took it as permission to just do whatever you want now. I'm not saying whether that's right or wrong, but you know, we're on the tail end of it, surely, right? Provided there's no second lockdown and a second wave. Touch wood, which there's got to be after. I mean, I'll tell you what I got up to on the day that the pubs reopened, but because people can sort of mix now, can they? I don't know. Can bubbles, households mix? I don't know what the rules are, but I am going to start having in the flesh guests again. I'm going to be selective with it. I'm going to be careful with it. I don't know if I can, you know, make people sign disclaimers and stuff, but, you know, I'm going to, I think, have a select, you know, small group that I'll just, I can vet, that I can vouch for. You know, there's all the guests that I've had on, I have no idea where they're coming from, what they're getting up to, but I think I'll choose, you know, the squad, the A roster, the, you know, the first team, and we'll just get them on rotation. For now, I've been, you know, it's been really hard for me. It's been a chore, honestly, to be like the producer of this podcast. I'm like booking the guests is actually makes it sound more intense than it is. It's literally just me Facebooking people, going, "Yeah, you said you might come on, do you fancy it?" But just sort of coordinating, getting everyone on and shit. And it can be awkward sometimes. I don't know everyone that well, and I've had a great time doing, I'm still going to be getting them on. But I think I'm comfortable now to just have a trusted, you know, tight, close friends unit that we can keep on repeat, because I'll do solo ones as well. And we'll have guests come in, all you know, interesting guests, better than my friends. Get them on still, but sometimes, man, it's been like, you know, it's embarrassing for me sometimes, getting people who I respect their work, you know, artists and shit, getting them round, and then, you know, if you're just listening, Pretendship's on YouTube as well, and it looks kind of cool, I think. If I do say so myself, I might be way off. Maybe it looks silly as fuck, but you know, it sort of looks a certain way anyway. And then when people turn up, I can see them like sometimes visibly disappointed, because it's just like in my house, and they're like, oh, and like my house ain't cool or anything. You know, it's not some like Instagrammable crib. And I don't know. Maybe that's my own weird thing. Man, I shouldn't be embarrassed. Stupid, but. There's other, you know, I don't know if she'll want me telling this, actually. Maybe it's not even a story to her, the subject of the story, but sometimes little awkward things happen with the guests where no one's, like, outstayed their welcome yet, but I could imagine that might happen, you know, if someone's, like, not reading the social cues or Tanya wants them to scram. But there was a chick, Fleur Rouge, on an episode, you know, some few months ago or whatever. Fuck, we've been doing this for like half a year now. Damn. Yeah, that's weird. Sorry, that just occurred to me. It's been over half a year now. Fuck. Anyway, this chick Fleur Rouge came on. We have a great chat. Get on famously. She's like a natural. She's like an. I've worked with her before. I already knew her. Like, good musician and shit. And my house, right, is we're like a flat upstairs in a house. So you have to come in through this like corridor. There's the front door, which we share with the bottom flat. Then you come in, and then there's like our door that is also locked. So there's like two doors to lock to get in. I always make the joke, it's like a bank vault where, or, you know, like a fucking jeweler's in Uncut Gems, where you have to come in and like wait in the holding room for me to like lock the front door for the downstairs flat and then unlock our door. Just forget about all that. It's a tight little corridor through which you have to like awkwardly wait while I'm like unlocking and locking doors and shit, right? So normally, you know, I like open the door, I have to like beckon you in, you have to walk real close to me, like your face comes and I'm like, good to see you, good to see you. Then I have to close this door, you just have to sort of wait over there, and then I have to like budge past you, excuse me, and then I've taken to not even trying to lock that door. I just sort of tell people as we're going upstairs, I go, just make sure that door's closed behind you, right? Anyway, this is all pertinent information for the story. We're about to leave. You know, we've been chatting, getting along great. Good episode. If you want to go and check it out, and rate, comment, and subscribe. So we're heading out, and I have this like guilt sometimes with guests where I feel like as if I've used them or something. As they're leaving, or as it becomes clear, like now it's time for you to go, I always feel like, oh, that they're going to be like, oh yeah, so you've finished talking to me now, have you? You used me for your podcast and now you're just kicking me out. I'm sure they're like happy to leave. I'm sure they're like, they want to leave, but they don't want to be rude or something. I don't know, like everyone always gets paranoid about themselves, don't they? Like, what's everyone thinking about me? But everyone else is thinking like that. I'm rambling. Fleur's about to leave, right? And I'm letting her out. And I lock my door and I'm unlocking this door. I always try and make it friendly because I have this guilt. I'm always like, thank you so much for doing this. And, you know, I don't want to just be like, goodbye. So I'm going for like to give her a little hug, right? We've met before, we've hugged before. It's not like, I'm not like presuming that she wants this physical embrace. But it's so tight there that she's already walking past me. And I'm like, now I have to sort of close her off from being able to leave with my other shoulder. Otherwise, the arm that I went to just like go around her back for the hug just looks like I'm shoving her out the door. So I've made it even worse. Like, I wanted to look friendly. I'm looking even more as if I want her out, right? Are you following this story or not? So I feel like I'm just chatting shit now. So I'm trying to go for a hug. It feels to her, perhaps in my mind, like I might be pushing her out. That's my fear. So I'm like, right, I have to make it very clear that it's a hug. So I go like, I'm almost like trying to go in at her so that she knows it's a hug. It makes it worse. And maybe she didn't even clock any of this, right? But I'm like, bye. And she's like, in my mind, she goes, what are you doing? And it might have been as simple as like, oh, what are you doing? Like, oh, you're coming with me. Like, it might have been like that, like as if I was like coming out the door and she's like, oh, where are we going? You know, oh, what are you doing? Like, I don't know what, it keeps playing in my mind. Like, what are you doing? What are you doing? And I'm trying to like decode what she might have meant by it. But it honestly did seem a little bit like I was like, come here, goodbye. Or I don't know what she, or even if the hug, maybe just the hug is weird. Maybe she didn't think it was any more than it actually was. And that creeped her out. But I went, she went, what are you doing? I went, oh, I'm just going for a hug. Like, she was already out the door. She went, what are you doing? I went, oh, just a hug. She went, oh yeah, gave me a hug. I was like, see you later, bye. And then I closed the door and I was like, oh man, oh, that's really mortifying. And I actually considered texting her, like, I don't know what you thought was going on then. There was no way to like elaborate or sort of make it less awkward. It was just, it was fucking awkward, wasn't it? But yeah, I want to avoid. I'll be happy that there'll be less chance for shit like that to be going on, you know, going forward. Yeah, but so to be clear, solo episodes like this, I'll still do just because it's like the easiest one to do. I'm doing this like just before you see it. I'll be getting guests round just as I always have been, and they'll also be just like the you know, the prime squad, the dream team, just on heavy rotation. Yeah, I want to stop it being as much like a, you know, like Joe Rogan's thing. Not that it's anything like that, but in the sense that it's, you know, people like, who's on this week? I don't really want to make it like that as much anymore. I just want it to be like, you know, you can, it's a bit more like reliable week to week. It will probably be quite similar rather than like, you know, a 45 minute episode with a makeup artist and then like a 4-hour episode with a, like a circus acrobat or something. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And I will be happy not to have those like awkward moments anymore. There's been a few of them, but I don't want to make anyone die inside by outing them as having been part of one of them. It reminded me of when I was a kid. I was going out with this girl, right? Like, she developed super early. We're like in year six. She had C cups. I'm not shitting you. And I'd been going out with her for like at least months. Like, but going out at that age just means like I go around to her house to watch Drop Dead Fred and sort of try and look down a top, and we sort of like kiss each other and she sits on my knee and shit like that. And I remember we were like walking out of school one time and I went to hug her and I just hadn't calibrated the hug properly. Like, when you're a kid, you just, you know, someone's there walking across you and you just sort of reach out and go for the hug, right? But she was a different fucking shape than all the other kids that I knew because she had these child breasts sticking out in front of her, right? So I go to like hug her, I'm like, ha, and I go to hug her. I just brushed the tit on the way and go like, oh, like carry on round. But it wasn't even a millisecond before she'd like been primed with this, you know, it's like as if she'd been like media trained by her parents or something. Like, as soon as the hand brushed the tit, she went, don't touch those, please. And I was like, and I remember thinking like, I wouldn't be trying to like cop a feel, would I? Like, and if I, and I also thought, is this bad? I felt like if I was, we are going out. We've been going out. Like, it's not the end of the world, is it? You know, don't touch those, please. Those are my breasts, and I would ask you not to interfere with them any longer. Anyway. Yeah, crazy that she had massive titties for a child. But yeah, lockdown's over, I think. Is it? Did everyone go out? I went out and got hammered. I've been really desperate too, man. I went out partly because I knew it would be awful. I know some people are like party animals and they just didn't go out because they're like, why would I go, like, and get a better party going at my house than, you know, social distancing in a pub or what have you. And yeah, I totally get that. I wasn't going out to have like the best night ever. I was going out because it was a historic night. That was like a unique event in human history, was it not? Where it's like never before, as far as I don't know shit about history, so maybe it's happened loads of times, maybe during the plague people weren't allowed out for a year, but as far as I know, people were never kept from seeing other people, strangers, the world over for months on end before. It was a very unique and novel sort of environment that had been created by the whole COVID thing, right? And everyone's missing each other. It's like depressing for people. Everyone's struggling with like money and not knowing what's going on with work and maybe like friends and extended family or whatever. Grandparents are catching COVID. Whatever, it's like, it's not been mega pleasant, has it? And then no one's allowed to see each other. And then it was the first day where this, like, it was like the World Cup or something. I wanted to go out and just look at everyone's faces. Like, you've not had this. Like, obviously you got, what, Piccadilly Gardens or whatever before the pubs were open. And you could see that, you know, it was like, whoa, you know, wow, we're in a group. And it's honestly a little bit odd to be in a group, isn't it? I keep feeling that, like, when I'm, you know, if I have to nip to Manchester for something, I'm like, fucking weird, so many people around, because I've been, everyone's so used to being just like on your own or in your tight little bubble, they call it. And I thought, I've got to go out and see what this is like, just like the first, just to, even just to say I was there, or just like, you know, think back on it. This was our thing that our generation lived through. I know it was, you know, it was no Great Depression or fucking war. We didn't get sent off to the countryside and discover Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, did we? But, you know, it was a weird, unique thing, and I wanted to go out and see what it was like. Manchester was like NHS track and trace, signing forms, going in bars. You have to leave this bar after two drinks and don't look at the bartender in the eye, you know, just like weird rules. And we enjoyed that for a time. And then I thought, I want to see as many cities and towns as possible. Let's get the fuck out of here, get back to my hometown, Atherton. Shouts to anyone from Atherton that's watching or listening. I don't know who the fuck is actually watching and listening, you know. These things get like 100 views. And then I put out a thing like, who, send me some questions. No one fucking sends any. I have got some for later, but like only 6 or 7 people sent them. So many people just like lurking, or I wish I could get more detailed analytics on who's watching. But yeah, I thought, let's go back to Atherton, right? And all bets were off, mate. It was pandemonium. It was like, I think at best I saw, you know, at the end of the night, it was like 2 or 3 in the morning, and a bartender in the last pub we were in was like, step back from the bar somewhat. I think those were his exact words. Yeah, the rest of the night, everyone's just lezzing off with each other and cartwheeling around, and it was wonderful. And maybe we're all bad people, I don't know, but the law said that it was all right. And you can't blame us, right, for just going out and fucking celebrating being alive. It's been difficult for a lot of people. Not crazy difficult for me, I'm not saying I've had that bad a time. Actually, I've been really lucky with work and, you know, visiting people on social distance, slacklining adventures, or, you know, all that type of shit. But, yeah, it was time to go out and get hammered. And we're all just like crammed in a pub, just getting on it. It was good times, man. But yeah, I will. Yeah, what else has been going on? I want to have a bit of a podcast before I get to answering these questions. Yeah, I've said what's going on with changing it around a little bit. Yeah, I tried doing the question thing. I don't know if anyone caught the last few episodes. I don't think I'm very good at it. I really wanted to be like, oh, this will be cool. Let's have this themed thing where I ask questions, and some people be laughing because they were like, oh yeah, he's changing it. And then like a few episodes later, I'm like, let's not change it. Let's change it back. But if you saw them, they were good episodes actually, but I think I'm just not great at doing the question thing, and it's got good benefits to it. You know, just from my side, it helps me sort of structure it a little bit better. But look how good these unstructured ones are, eh? Yo, did you see that came out the other day, like this week? There's a new star sign. It's like an octopus star sign. I don't know what's going on with it. Like I didn't want to read it because I don't know. It's like rots your brain reading about shit like that, right? But what did NASA discover? That it had been, you know, whoever came up with the 12 star sign thing had sort of missed one off, because like, oh, that doesn't really fit into, there's 12 months, 12 star signs, that's nice, we'll just fuck off that octopus one. But there is an octopus one, and then they had to like budge everyone else around, which no one will be happy with, right? But think about this, if you're really upset about it and you've got a tattoo of your star sign, or your identity is like the star sign, and you're upset about this, just think about this, you are retarded, aren't you? Fucking star signs. Ridiculous. Adults. I talk to adults all the time. I had my mate, I won't name him because I'm also going to talk about the same girl later on, but my mate was like dating a girl recently during lockdown, don't tell anyone. And she was giving it like an adult person, giving it like, oh, so what's your sign? Oh, we can't be together, we're both Tauruses. And it's like, I sort of get if people are doing it ironically or just like, you know, I'll read a horoscope just for like a laugh. Just be like, look, read my horoscope, and then just like, ha ha ha, that's dumb. But people who like genuinely make decisions based on it and think that there's some validity to it. And yeah, I can't get in that headspace, like what your life has to be where this is convincing to you. So am I jealous or upset by it? I don't know. But yeah, that was a weird thing that happened this week. Maybe I'll do little topical bits. Don't know. Should I do that? I'm happy, you know. Happy to be having people back in. I've missed people. Got some good guests coming up. I'm happy, actually, that lockdown's easing off, even though it's not been, like, horrifically difficult for me. But I am very pleased that life's returning to normal, obviously for like all the reasons you might think, but one of the main things that I'm just like thrilled about now is I hope that people will be spending less time on social media, because this whole period's just forced people, to just be in their homes. Like I would imagine if I had like maths and graphs of it, it was like, you know, steady whatever, and then lockdown, and then just bang, just Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, just and like, you know, triple, quadruple the amount of time per user that they're on it of a day. And that's not, it's not healthy, is it? Like I've never been one of them that's like, everyone's addicted to sharing articles of, look, this artist got rid of, photoshopped people's phones out of their hand to show how disconnected we are. And I've always thought, mate, people would just like do other things before that, like read a newspaper or look out of the window. People never wanted to like hang out 24/7, and we have the best technology in the world, right? Social media, it can connect us and just use it for your own ends. Don't, you know, if you're not just sharing nonsense and like getting into, you know, just vapid pursuits, it can be good. You can use it to keep in touch with your friends and share cool shit. But it is, I sound like an old guy, but it's like a, it's just like engenders this sort of out, it's an outrage factory, isn't it? It's just like the types of things that do best on there that sort of smash it best in terms of engagement and numbers and shit on any social media thing is like the most, well, on Facebook really, it's not really on like Instagram necessarily, but yeah, Facebook, like news articles, and I don't know, it's just like divisive, making people angry, like aggressive, just like kicking off with each other. And why would you want that? Like the whole, the Black Lives Matter thing. For the record, I don't know, like I already did a thing, like an episode about this a few ago, but for the record, I'm not certain. I think I spoke about it already if you want to go back, but I'll just like re-elucidate. Is that the right term? I couldn't be more against examples of racism in society, of injustice, of, you know, any unfair treatment of anyone. Like I just detest any of that. And I think I just made like the point that one, Black Lives Matter is like this branded sort of movement that isn't exactly aligned with what it should be, or I don't know. I was just sort of making the point that a lot of people have getting, I don't know, it's a difficult one to talk about, isn't it? I think that, calls to defund the police, for example, is a bit ridiculous. I think there is a big problem with police, especially in America, but in the UK as well. They don't have enough money or training that you need funding for, not paid enough, not trained well enough for long enough, need to be maybe strategically defunded, like demilitarized. Fair. I know that we're getting, I didn't want to get too heavy into it. I'm sorry to anyone that's sick of hearing about it, but I just wanted to be clear about my position so that I can tell you a story. Yeah, it's just like, I think saying defund the police or all cops are bastards, get rid of the police is ridiculous. I don't think that's what Black Lives Matter are necessarily saying, but if you are saying that, or like if you're saying defund the police and you mean fully get rid of the police, I just think it's a bit like stupid, honestly. They need to be trained, in my view, in social work, you know, so you can like de-escalate situations, be better at, you know, dealing with homeless and people who are mentally ill and stuff like that, because there's a lot of stupid laws about, you know, there's laws about, you know, minor drug offences, and, you know, there's things that can be dealt with totally differently by police. You know, if you don't give them money, then they go to like the cheapest. Everyone's seen like the documentaries recently and stuff. Obviously, we would need a national database of the bad eggs that they're being called, so that, you know, if one's been complained about, maybe on like a civilian review board, you know, like public forum, like some place where you can review your experiences with police, and police that are being complained about, you can't just move them around, like it's known about, and they have to be held accountable. All these things I think are sensible, right? And just saying get rid of police so that you can have you know, private security firms or whatever, like, what are you on about? Like, how are we going to deal with large-scale crimes, fucking trafficking, and, you know, just, you need every level of law enforcement to coordinate on certain things. You're going to have just, like, your neighbourhood watch. Fucking, anyway, we're getting off point now. Like, so I was saying in my Black Lives Matter pod that I did, my Black Lives Matter pod, as if anyone gives a fuck. I just thought it was silly that a lot of people were, you know, the wokies or whatever, you know, people just sort of using it for internet points, really. Like, I got no, you know, it's good, isn't it, that people are absolutely incensed by what they perceive to be a systemic racism or, you know, injustice in society. Good, you should be angry if you think that's going on. But I think people sort of using it to attack other people and just like, it seems very like tribalistic and aggressive and like, I don't know, it never sits well with me that you could decide that you're, you know, like be sanctimonious and decide that you, I mean, everyone thinks that they're right, obviously, but, you know, deciding that your way is the only way and everyone else basically doesn't deserve to live, or I don't know what, you know, I've seen some, that sounds hyperbolic, but I've seen some fucking well aggressive things from, honestly, not from racists. I honestly have seen like one or two people genuinely that I'm like, well, that's racist, isn't it? You know, and then everyone else on the other side, just like, if you say, whoa, wait a minute, you know, just, I happen to, for example, not give a fuck if statues come down, like slave trader statues. I'm just like, yeah, whatever, you know, who cares about a statue anyway? But, you know, if someone dares to go, should we, I don't know if we should necessarily hold, you know, like some people are known slave traders and that's their main thing. Some people were just sort of complicit, but, you know, like, and that's bad for sure, but, you know, some people weren't known for slave trading, they did loads of good shit, and then they're just getting torn down as well, and then people that might defend that and go, oh, I don't know if we can hold people accountable by today's ethics and morals, and then, you know, like besmirch their memory as a result of that. If they dare to even, like, you know, go, can we have a conversation about it? Then you've got these, like, crazy, you know, the wokies, I don't know what you want to call them, just going like, yeah, this is a microaggression. This is the start of white supremacy. That's what I got. I literally just said, there was some video a couple of weeks ago, and it was like a black dude getting arrested for something, and the police officer was handling it really poorly, probably bad training, whatever. Maybe he was racist, or no. There was no evidence that he was racist, in my view, in the video. Nothing remotely to indicate that it was, like, racially motivated, the arrest, or that something was being handled, except that the guy was black, do you know what I mean? And then I was like, oh, I don't know. Like, someone was like, look at this. Oh, my God, Hitler would be laughing. And I was like, I don't know about that. Like, let's not lose our minds. And then some chick just, like, laid into me. This is 8:30 in the morning on, like, a Tuesday morning. Some chick's, like, caught, like, leaving big paragraphs saying, like, I'm a covert white supremacist and this, and I was just like, wow, this is fucking crazy, man. This is like, that was my issue anyway, that I was on about. I feel like I've lost my point, but I'm saying where I stood on it is, you know, I just think using this issue to, like, it's very divisive. It's upsetting me. I'm fucking glad that I'm not single right now, because trying to date, because let's be honest now, the overwhelming majority of the, you know, the social justice patrol, white chicks about this age that I am, you know, mid-20s, in anywhere in your 20s, right? And I just couldn't handle it. That's another thing that the girl I was on about before, that my mate was dating, she was like, where do you stand on defunding the police? And he was like, oh, for fucks. And if you don't get it right, it's, they're basically saying, tell me what it, and if you don't say the correct password, they're just like, just fucking crazy, man. And I feel for them, because they want to be a good person. For my money, it's misguided. But they, you know, it's like, say, a religious person. They think, no offense, religious people, but you have to admit, don't you? In your view, although you're right, everyone else of different religions, you think they're misguided and silly, don't you? Like, I don't know which one I want to offend now by using as an example. If you're a Jew, an Orthodox Jew, right, or a, you know, non-practicing sort of cultural Jew, everyone else got it wrong, didn't they? Just like, well, they're silly, yeah, they are. Well, I'm not, but all of them, every single other religion except mine, they're the silly one. That's what Muslims think, that's what presumably Buddhists think, Christians think it, don't they? They, you know, they are an atheist about all other religions except their one, and, you know, just by virtue of having been born in the correct country that Christianity is has been the majority religion, they are lucky enough to have been born into the one true religion, aren't they? My point is, religious people think that they're right and they're doing a nice thing. So if a religious person prays for you, I've been prayed for by, recently, within the past few months, been prayed for by a friend of mine, and he put his hand on my throat because I bust my throat, didn't I, obviously, over a year ago now. Fuck, whoa, time is flying. Damn. Yeah, anyway, a mate of mine put his hand on my throat and prayed for me. And, you know, obviously, in my view, in many people's view, it's of no use at all. But I wasn't like, laughing it off. I'm like, this is lovely. My friend cares about me so much that he's trying his best now to heal me, doing something that he thinks, well, like, it's like he's fucking buying me medicine or something, like he's trying his best, and that's lovely, isn't it? What a lovely thing to do. And I guess that's what, you know, all the woke squad are doing. Like, they think this is, they're on the right side of history and this is the best thing to do. And honestly, but in my, like, from my perspective, it it could be making it worse. That's the only reason. I'm not just being contrary. I wasn't just trying to be like, well, what about this? You know, just devil's advocate. I honestly think I want to progress society. I want everyone to have equal rights and for no one to ever feel upset about, you know, discrimination unfairly against something that's outside of their control. You know, race, disabilities, gender, sexuality, any of that shit. And I honestly think that their attitude could make things worse. In the immediate present, I think, you know, like in America, for example, I think all the calls to defund the police and all that shit potentially aids Trump getting reelected. I don't normally like to touch politics. And, you know, I've always said when people are like, stupid Trump, I'm like, what are his policies? And they're like, it's just... You said something about bleach, or he's got stupid hair, and I'm like, you don't really know anything about politics, do you? You don't know what a president is to do, what they should be doing. I agree, it looks like he's a fucking idiot and a liar, but is that, does that sort of preclude him from being an effective president? I think that's more contrary what I was saying there, because I do think that it's really damaging to like America and probably the world that Trump did get in, as far as I can tell, but I don't know, right? But I do think, I hesitate to use all the buzzwords and shit, but like the hyper left, you know, the woke left using all the, you know, defund the police and all cops are bastards, ACAB, ACAB, that's the one that was going around, wasn't it? I think all that, you see in Trump's, what's it called? You know, the numbers, what's it called? Something rates, what's it called? Like everyone, if everyone likes you, then your numbers go up. Yeah, I'm showing myself up for how little I know about it all. I think his, you know, it's if he runs as what I've heard been called the, he sort of presents himself as a law and order president. And people who might not have voted for Trump, people that were slightly more apathetic or whatever, when they start hearing from the other side, oh yeah, we need to get rid of police and stuff, they go, oh, for fuck's sake, right, so if I want police, I've got to vote for this idiot. I don't know, I'll get off politics because I don't fucking know shit about it. I'm just, all I'm saying is those, you know, that whole group of people sort of make me laugh a little bit. That, you know, it's like, hey, don't forget about justice for Breonna Taylor on the story. And then you flick to the next story and they're like, hey, look at my titties. I'm out on a night out. Look at these titties. It's like such a weird, like, you know, it'd be like, oh my God, did you even, you know, even trying to outdo each other with how many woke things they know about and shit, which is bring attention to it, all that shit. Do something about it. Vote for the right people. That's my sort of stance on it. If you vote for the right people, bring in the right policies, affect genuine change, sign the petitions, go to the protests. Posting shit on Facebook, I think, does less to raise awareness and more to express your identity, isn't it? I don't know. It was silly on my last solo one, if anyone caught it. I did have a couple mates say, oh, I didn't watch it because when you started talking about Black Lives Matter, I was like, for fuck's sake, I can't be bothered at hearing even more about this, especially from this fucking idiot. I used idiot for Trump and myself in really quick succession there, and I wouldn't have. My brain suggested Hmong, but I thought, oh God, if any of the types of people I'm talking about, the lefty hyper justice activist warriors are watching, they're not going to like me saying Hmong, are they? Didn't I say retard before? Or retarded? I don't know, they're not watching this shit anyway. So yeah, some of my friends didn't want to watch the last one because I'm a Hmong. But what did I say in that? I said something about like no lives matter, or I don't care enough at one point. obviously I care about all the injustices. I just disagree that despite there being 100% without question deep racism present in society, just pervasive, just like infecting every level of, you know, businesses and culture and all that shit. I just think if this is crazy that this is crazy to say, but I just think the facts and figures do not reflect that, in my view, despite all the trending documentaries you might have been watching, in my view, the facts and figures do not indicate that the police is a, you know, intrinsically racist system. There are issues, yeah. Let's get them changed. That, I think that I also did say on that last show, there's systemic change necessary. I outlined some 5-10 minutes ago. I don't think we need to get rid of all police. I think, if you start on with all this rhetoric that why don't we turn it into one of these podcasts again? Fuck, I'll get it back round and we'll go to questions. Let me just finish it. I think with all this that they're coming out with now, you scare real police off. There was something that happened after the original, you know, like when Black Lives Matter first got popularized as a hashtag in Ferguson in America. You had this effect after it where crime went up because police were like, oh, I can't touch anything because we're going to be on the news. So, police went in and just sort of left things to it. Good police quit because they're just like, I can't, you know, either they think, are we all pieces of shit? You know, and then they just get out of there. They're like, I didn't want it to ever be that. Or, you know, good police are prevented from joining the police. Good people are prevented from joining the police. And you end up with just the type of person that wants to be, a prison officer. Other types of people that now want to be police, or, you know, fucking actual racists who think lower of other races. I don't know, man. It's a weird one, isn't it? Race, you know, with that attitude as well, it just becomes like very divided racially, I think, a little bit as well. You've got the whites all going oversensitive. Black people are going to be wondering which type of white they're talking to when they're interacting with. They're like, is this one of the ones that's going to be like, you know, all trying to apologize to me and like ask me about my experience as a POC, and are they going to be like, fuck, is it the other types of whites who are like sick of them and they're going to be like weird with me about, like, just because it's an issue, innit? Like, I'm hoping, I think the goal is what I've heard called by, I think it was Coleman Hughes, it might have been Sam Harris, a post-racial society, right? Where race is as interesting to someone as the colour of your fucking hair. You know what I mean? As important, as of as much value as, you know, if someone's ginger or brunette or whatever. It was Sam Harris who said, although you should check out some Coleman Hughes, but prepare to be triggered. And this is not like a right guy at all. He's not like a heavy conservative guy at all. But I just thought, I've been, you know, checking out a lot of that guy right now, so I'd give him a recommendation. Harris said something to the effect, he used the analogy of like, you know, do you know how many blonde people work at, you know, BBC News or whatever? And you're like, no, why would I know that? But it's like, there's always quotas of how many black and white people should be in a business. You know what I mean? Why am I touching this issue again? I should stay away from it, shouldn't I? I'm saying the goal, I think, is a post-racial society where race is of no interest to, you know, it's like, who cares about that? Everyone's just equal, judged on the content of the character. Isn't that what Martin Luther King said? And the same for like gender and sexuality and stuff, you know, where you wouldn't have to come out to your parents like, I'm, you know, if you went, I'm gay, they'd be like, right, and what, you know, just it's boring. No one's like, I'm straight. Like, unless it has seemed as if you're not straight. Is that a thing? Do people who seemed gay and they've quietly deciding, like, fuck, I thought I was gay in school just because maybe it was like, you know, I had a crush on a guy or, you know, no girls fancy me or whatever. And then turns out I think I'm just into girls. And then you have to go, like, hang out with all your girlfriends or whatever. And you're like, I think I'm actually straight. And they're all like, what? Maybe that is a thing. I don't know. Anyway, I think we can get there. I think we can make it. I think we can get to past all the race stuff. And I hope that, you know, the types of people I'm complaining about, who I don't know what word to call them, lefties, wokies, social justice warriors, all those guys, I hope that they evolve their approach and their understanding, and I hope that it's helpful. I think we'll get there, and it will be a little bit because of them, and probably a good degree despite them as well. But I'm hopeful that we get there, and let's just, like, not divide each other and be tribalistic and hating people for their beliefs and shit. Let's just poke fun at each other, sure, but who the fuck do I think I am, like, telling everyone how they should be? So we just move it on. Let's do some questions, shall we? I had some sent in. I don't know if I'm going to keep doing, like, questions, because I keep asking people to send them in, and people don't send them in. Please send in if you've got problems with your relationships, like agony aunt style. If you've got medical queries, I'll have a pop at them. Why not? It'll be funny. Do a picture, a poem, sing a song, send videos. Like, not many people watch this, but maybe it's going to get views later on. Send me some videos and I'll pop you up and everyone will watch you or listen to you. Get some exposure for your thing. I'll just do free shout outs. Why not? Let's see what questions I got. So Madikazi Azmi sent a question. He's been on the show before, and we hit a lot of race stuff, if you want to go and check that out. That, I would imagine, has aged. I haven't gone back and watched it. I would imagine it's sort of gotten more interesting now since we did it. So Madikazi Azmi, if you want to go and watch that, I can't remember what episode number it was. He said, if you could have any artist, dead or alive, on your podcast, who would it be and why? I'm assuming that he means, I'm trying to give you what you want, Marty. And you, I would imagine, are asking for, like, a musical artist, like maybe my favorite ever. But, you know, I'd love to hear a podcast of someone talking to Eminem, for example, but I wouldn't want for me to talk to it, because he'll just be like, there's nothing I've got for him. He's like operating on a different fucking level than me, or maybe not like higher than me, but just like way over there. Like, I've got nothing for him. He's not going to be interested in what I'm saying. You know, I think if I ever met Eminem, I'd just try and like rap for him, and he'd be like, yeah, cool. And then I'd regret it for the rest of my life. I'd be like, oh my God, did I just rap in front of Eminem? And yeah, that'd be funny. Does artist include comedians? Does it include mixed martial artists? Does that count, or is that a stretch? If it includes comedians, do you know what? I think, I don't know, like, my favorite comedian is a guy called Big J Okerson. And he does podcasts as well. I don't actually listen to it because there's a bunch of people on the podcast and it's just a bit like of noise and I don't know the other people and shit, but I love his stand-up and I'd love to get him in, and I think we would probably get on. However, I think just because he's like American and I'm English. There's too much of a cultural divide for us to connect properly. So I think I'd get on who I think is, in my view, the best comedian, Stuart Lee. He's also the comedian that people say if they're trying to seem intelligent. But I think, as we're both English, I think he'd sort of get, I don't think he'd mind that it's just some poxy little podcast. I think he'd sort of embrace it for what it was and still try and have a good conversation. And he's a font of knowledge. I'd just sap him and just drink all his wisdom out of him. And I'd just do a 17-hour podcast until he was dead. And then I'd be the new Stuart Lee. So I hope that answers your question, Mardy. A question from Shinsun. Go and check out Shinsun on Instagram. Some good pictures on there. Lovely young Shinsun. She asked, what have been the best and worst aspects of doing the pod now that it's been a good while since you started? Honestly, like I was saying at the start of the episode, the worst part has been just like the logistics. The actual podcast itself is just a delight to do when I can have a guest in. Just bouncing off each other, and there's a little bit of like playing up to the camera a little bit inevitably. But I like that. It's sort of like a fun game rather than just, you can let the energy die if you're with someone in real life. They can just go, and start texting. Do you know what I mean? But you have them and they have to be on and like invested in the conversation. So it's good to sort of force people to be in a good conversation with you. It's my favorite. But yeah, just all the trying to book it, and it takes me like, it's like a part-time job. I have to like, I'm not, woe is me, but if you're asking what the worst part, I'll gladly take that sacrifice. But yeah, just the editing of it takes like often like a couple of days to edit it. Full days sitting at my computer just like going through it. Yeah, that's the worst part. The best part of it is that I don't mean to get too deep, but I think I was a little bit I'd fallen out with, you know, the universe a little bit, with God a little bit, if you want to use that word. I was a little bit upset about, I don't want to keep banging on about my voice, but obviously not Pretendship if I'm not crying about my damn voice. But yeah, I think I thought, oh, I'm not going to be able to speak properly now for the rest of my life. And I'd always, you know, I hadn't put any effort into being anything else except someone that could sort of orate. Do you know what I mean? Like I'd always just, it had always been my favorite thing to just be in conversation with people. And I thought, oh, I've sustained this injury now and I'm not going to be able to modulate my pitch and use voices and do silly noises and make as full a use of the full range of the human voice that I'd basically had, you know, 20 odd years practice at consciously trying to get better at that. And it had been, you know, snatched away from me. And I thought, fuck, man, I'm not, my favorite shit is going to be spoiled for me now. You know, let's say you just love music and you're a musician and you sing all the time, you play piano or whatever, you know, whatever, just like music's your life, and then you just get like severe tinnitus or you break your fingers or some shit, I don't know. Yeah, and I think it was, it became quickly apparent when I'd started doing it that it wasn't going to be too much of a hindrance. I was obviously having to, you know, I mean, might be able to hear my voice now getting a bit sore, but, you know, just drink some water and I'll be cool. And, you know, anyone just speaking without stopping for, you know, chunnering on for an hour, it's going to get tired, your voice, innit. But yeah, I think just starting to do the podcast and going, oh, you know, it's fun and I am having fun and I'm chatting to people and I can't really put my finger on, you know, I can't diagnose any problems that it's actually presenting other than like not being able to go for very long without being in pain. But who wants to listen to it for more than like an hour or two anyway? And you know, getting interest of people and, like, you know, things that people say about it, you know, just my good friends saying, like, that they listen to it is just, like, means a lot to me. Because I honestly thought that I'm like, fuck, I used to be, you know, very cartoony and animated and you know, with how I spoke. And I feel as if now it's a little bit more like, do you know what I mean? Just monotonous. But apparently there's enough in there to get your teeth into. I don't know. That's the best and worst parts. Thanks, Shane's son. Danny Micklebra says, 2 licks for a fiver. Yeah. Yeah, sure, man. Can do that. Brett Jones. Brett R. Jones is a legend. Brett Jones. If you want to go on, he does, like, charity stuff. So if you like to make yourself feel like a good person, go and stay abreast of what he does, because he's always raising money for shit. He asks, will there ever be a boy born who can swim faster than a shark? I don't know how fast sharks swim. Surely not, though. Definitely not. Sharks, mate. How fucking cool are sharks? Just this big muscle just through the water. They just... all everyone else just knows to get out the fucking way. They're just psychopaths, aren't they? Just big eating machines. I always found 2 little factoids about sharks. Apologies if you're annoyed by the word factoid. I don't know what it means. Probably not correct to use it. Fact. 2 shark facts. 1. I think fish are even less related to sharks than they are to us. Or, like, I shouldn't have said fact and then just come out with, like, me going, I think a shark one time did. If we're talking about sharks, fish and people, sharks and fish are not close to each other over here on, like, the, you know, all life family tree. It's like 3 points of a triangle, right? They're just fuck all like fish. They've not got the same shit going on inside them, which blew my mind. I'm sure if you look it up, you'll find interesting information that I've just given you the cause for, you know, I've just piqued the curiosity, and you can go off and, you know, investigate it yourself. Another little fact about sharks. Sharks predate trees. Fucking trees. There was plants around, but there's something like, I wish I had the figures for you. But yeah, sharks were knocking about for millions of years, and then the first tree was born. Think about that. You look outside, trees just seem to predate animals, don't they? Sharks, fucking been around for ages, mate. Maybe it was megalodons, I don't know. But let's see what else. Callie Black, which is, I don't know if she'd want me to say a real name or not. She messaged me off this account, so we'll just say Callie Black. Callie Black, if anyone is wants to see, you know, titties and shit like that, that's what she does. She's what's the term for someone that does OnlyFans? A webcam model, a internet whore. But yeah, Callie Black says, open up WhatsApp and in the search bar type in boobs, tits or bappies. She knows me well. That's what I would have said, bappies. Scroll to the 10th conversation containing that word and read it out. I do apologise, Callie, but I tend to get rid of all my WhatsApp chats like once a week. Like, I've literally got like maybe like a dozen, 15, something like that. I just get rid of them all the time. So, you know, even if I'd said it with anyone, it doesn't go back that far. There's no, yeah, there's not going to yield any results. I'm glad though, because I could have really gotten myself in trouble there, because I think if it was Facebook that you'd asked, there's a bunch of mentions of boobs, tits, bappies, pappers, hanging sloppers, swinging punches, knocks, what some other, I remember my dad calling him one time, pendulous doobries, which I'll give him some credit, that's a good one. What has been the most significant, oh, I should have, because I read half of the first one when she sent these and I thought, I'm just going to react to these live. But as I've started to read the second one, it looks like it might take some thought. So just bear with me. What's been the most significant plot twist in your own life other than the pandemic? Good question. Plot twist in my life other than the pandemic. Do you know what's been a plot twist in my life? I was convinced till I was 21 that I was going to die at 21. I know that sounds very dramatic, but I'd been told, I think many young men, and particularly like fuck-ups, like I probably categorise myself as, you know, just didn't do well academically or anything like that, didn't have any sort of plan. You just think, I'll fucking die anyway when I'm 27, won't I? I'll just be in prison or dead. I think a lot of people think like that. But I'd been told by my parents never to do drugs. That, you know, my dad's quite severely mentally ill. You know, he's got it all, mate. He's got schizophrenia or whatever they call that now, schizoaffective disorder, paranoia, manic depression, bipolar. Just all the best ones, right? And he's on like a gamut of, you know, meds and shit, and has been sectioned, you know, several times throughout his life. And my parents attribute that to his drug use. And they say, if you ever do drugs, you'll turn mental as well. And I was like, oh, fuck. And, you know, you say to a kid, don't do something, he's going to do it. So I felt like there was this, it was like my destiny to do drugs, lose my mind, and then just be fucked and that, and you know, just die of being insane or whatever. And then, you know, I started just like hammering drugs, obviously, because it was forbidden, but also just because it's maybe I'd have done it anyway. I'm not trying to blame them for guiding me towards it, but you know, drugs are fun, aren't they? Especially when you're like young. So I did a bunch of drugs and I just sort of had resigned to the idea that, yeah, so I'll do this for a few years and then I'll just, you know, die in my 20s, or at 21 probably, because I think that was the first time that he was sectioned. And I think a bunch of guys have this weird thing where they feel like they're destined to be like their fathers. I'm sure girls have it where they think they're going to turn into the mums, or everyone has some weird thing where you feel as if you're following the path of one of your parents, maybe. And I was, yeah, I did start to lose my my sanity a little bit, I think, just because I was like overdoing it, I think. But I got to 2021, and I was like, well, I'm not dead. And I also feel as if I'm with it. I don't feel like I've lost my critical faculties. So I eased off the drugs and packed it in, really. Within like 6 months, I just like sort of didn't do any of it anymore. You know, I didn't just come off it, because I think that's a little bit too strict, and maybe you could have some like negative effects off that, maybe. But and to be clear, I was only doing like the normal drugs that any 20-year-old would do now. I wasn't doing like crack or heroin or PCP, you know, just the recreational drugs, whatever. Packed it all in, and then, you know, wasn't mentally well. I certainly was depressed or apathetic or struggled a little bit, if I'm being totally candid with you. I think there was like doubts in my mind about like the nature of reality a little bit, which probably comes from, maybe from psychedelic use, I'm not sure, but you know, that sort of, I got my shit together, for lack of a better expression, and, you know, just sorted my diet out and my lifestyle and started sleeping at night, which was like unheard of for me, but I was sleeping at night in something of a routine, and just like completely recovered from whatever I was doing to my brain, and just felt fucking a million times better. And I was like, oh wait, so yeah, I'm not like my dad in that respect, and I'm over it, and I'm good, and I just won't do drugs anymore, and I'll just be fine. And I found out ages later, you know, like after I'd already, you know, it was like a couple of years ago now, I was talking to my dad about his drug use, you know, just sort of out of curiosity, because they made out like he was fucking drinking pints of acid or whatever. And I sort of asked him about it, and then he like divulged his, you know, what he'd done. And I was like, that's the squarest shit I've ever heard of. Like, he did coke twice and like fucking took a pill one time or something. And I was just like, you sound like the fucking lamest guy I've ever heard of. Like, you went nuts off all this. And I think he just had like a natural propensity, whatever the word is. I think he was almost certainly going to go that way, irrespective of drug use. I mean, he drank a lot, I don't know. But yeah, that was the plot twist in my life anyway. I thought that I was going to die or go mental or whatever in my 20s, and I didn't. And I feel like as well adjusted as I ever have, as I sit in a room in my house talking to a camera on my own for over an hour. You're going to be stuck, this is question 3 from Callie Black, you're going to be stuck on a desert island for 5 years. Fuck, that's annoying. You can only take 5 friends. Oh, you can't do this. This is like fucking MySpace. Your 5 top friends and why. Here's what I'll say. No, I can't do this one. Because I was going to say, I won't choose my best friends. I'll choose some industrious friends, right? But then they're going to be like, what, we're not your best friends? And then your best friends are going to be like, what, you don't think I'm industrious? No, I can't. I won't choose that one. Here's what I would say. I'm offered to take any 5 friends to the desert island, and I'm not going to take any. I'm not going to subject them to the desert island. I'm going to go. I'll be all right. I'll do it on my own. You guys can fuck off and live your lives, because I'm just selfless. I'm just dead nice. Question 4. There's 5 questions. And then, holy hell, we'll wrap this up. Question 4. The worst advice someone has given you. Oh, I wish I'd thought about this one. I don't remember any advice anyone's ever given me, if I'm honest. To level with you, I could not tell you a piece of advice that I've ever been given. I just can't think of anything anyone's ever told me to do. Literally, the only thing I can think that I've ever been told to do as advice is my mate Skywalker, and this is only because I spoke about it today, told me that if I'm opening a ring pull can, instead of getting my thumb under the, you know, like a can of beans or whatever, a tin of beans, instead of getting my thumb and ripping my nail off my nail bed a little bit, get a knife under there, just prise it up and open it like that. And I was like, what, you can't do it with your nail? You got little soft ass nails, mate. And he was like, no, it just hurts your nail a bit. And I was like, not my nail, I've got very strong nails. But then I went home and I tried it. It is well better than using your nail. That's the only advice I can think of. And the 5th question, what's my silliest fear? Oh, I don't know if it's, I'm sure a lot of people will consider it silly. Obviously, I don't consider it silly, else I wouldn't be afraid of it. My fear, one of my, I don't know if it counts as a fear, but I really shouldn't even start answering this. But yeah, I've been asked, and I did say, ask me anything. I've got like, I really don't like to see, I know this sounds so insensitive, I know I'm a piece of shit for for thinking this, but it really upsets me to see someone who's been burnt, like a burns victim. Just because I think there's something about, you know, like if your brain is like a pattern recognizer and it's a face recognizer, everyone sees face, a lot of people see faces and stuff where there isn't a face, like, ah, look, that tree looks like it's got a face, right? Because your brain's just ready to see faces. It knows, it's like when your phone just, you know, you get something and you're like, whoa, it's seeing a face in my knee there, look at that. That's what your brain's doing all the time, right? So when you mess with a face a little bit, it's really upset. It's like, it's jarring, isn't it? You know, if something's off about a face, that's why you have the uncanny valley, they call it in, you know, in AI and fucking robot development and shit. If something's nothing like a human, then you go, cool, whatever. A metal face with like light bulb eyes, sweet. If it looks exactly like a human, you're like, cool, a human. If it's a little bit like a human, but not quite there, then you're like, oh, what the hell? You know, if something's like bad, almost perfect CGI, or, you know, like a sex robot, you know, like a sex doll thing, you're just like, ugh, it's creepy. I'm sorry to have compared a creepy CGI thing or a robot with burns victims, but it's almost like a face, but something's wrong, and I feel so bad for, that's why I don't like seeing it, because I just feel for them so much. I just feel so upset for the person who's, you know, that they should be able to go out and live their life and not have any issues, and I'm reminded of their pain when I see them. Do you know what I mean? And maybe you should have the same for anyone who you can see something's going on with, you know, a wheelchair guy. You should be like, oh, fuck, man. Yeah, feel for your struggle, brother. And maybe the burns victim isn't asked. Maybe there isn't a problem. And they're just like, no, I've never been happier. I was, you know, actually in this book, that's, no way has it been brought around. In this book, Geek Love, there's a girl who, she's just like vacuous bint, just a cheerleader, and she's in a house fire, and she says it's the best thing that ever happened to her, because she's burned, she stops valuing her looks and using that as the only measure of her worth, and she becomes like a, you know, top scientist or whatever. So maybe they're just buzzing, and I'm presuming that they will be upset, but there's something about it. It's the sadness, the empathy for the person crossed, multiplied by, you know, that their face is almost like a typical face, but with a distortion to it. And it's really, really upsetting to me. And I'm just like, gutted, I'm sorry to say, when I see a burns victim, fuck, awful thing to say. Thank you for listening, for watching. If you want to see any changes, people very rarely sort of feedback or comment on it or anything, but if you like it, say what you like, or say what you want me to change. If you know, let's have a conversation, right? A conversation between you. What, have you seen that Garth Brooks video? Let the conversation begin. I hope I'm not being creepy like Garth. I don't know. I'm just trying to get engagement and shit, right? Send some shit in, comment on it. Just tell me what's... I don't know. Don't hide. Don't be lurking. Watch. There's people watching every episode. There must be, with the numbers that they get. So quit being secretive and announce yourself. More episodes, like I say, every weekend. We got friends coming. We got interesting, semi-acquainted friends coming. Solo ones. And I do value everyone watching and listening. Appreciate it. All right. I'll catch you. next week.